Welcome to Mount Hope Baptist Church this morning. We had a good time this weekend at the community yard sale. That was really fun, and it was a beautiful, beautiful day. I looked up in the sky, and I thought I saw the Son of Man coming on a chariot from the clouds of heaven, but it was just Chris Smith up on the lift there working on the steeple. So a little disappointment, but no, that was a good time, and it feels good to get rid of some things, doesn't it? Sometimes, for me, it almost feels better than getting something brand new, to just let some things go, and we can't take it with us, can we? But we've got treasure in heaven, and so I want to invite y'all this morning to stand up, and we'll sing In the Sweet By and By.
There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar. For the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore. We shall sing on that beautiful shore the melodious songs of the blessed. And our spirit shall sorrow no more, not a sigh for the blessing of rest. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. To our bountiful Father above, we will offer our tribute of praise for the glorious gifts of His love and the blessings that hallow our days. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, shall meet on that beautiful shore.
Let's shout to the Lord this morning.
Worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hands. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you. My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength, let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hands. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hands. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have. Nothing compares to the promise I have. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you.
Great and amazing are your deeds, O Lord, the God Almighty. Just and true are your ways, O King of the nations. Who will not fear, O Lord, and glorify your name? For you alone are holy. All nations will come and worship you, for your righteous acts have been revealed.
Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, early in the morning our song shall rise to thee. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity. Holy, 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 though the darkness hide thee, though the eye of sinful man thy glory may not see. Only thou art holy, there is none beside thee, perfect in power, in love and purity. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, all thy works shall praise thy name in earth and sky and sea. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity. God in three persons, blessed Trinity.
Amen. You may be seated. We have some announcements this morning.
Good morning. It is good to see you guys here. I have to break out the old phone because I've been getting announcements texted to me. So we have the bulletin and now the digital bulletin, apparently. So that's we'll run through all those this morning. It was good to see you guys. It's community yard sale this weekend. It was a great way to connect with our community, to love on one another. We actually ended up picking up a new van load of kids through the yard sale this weekend. So we're excited to add them to the routes coming up this Wednesday, and it's a family with 8 kids, and all ranging anywhere from kindergarten to 12th grade. So we're looking forward to having the opportunity to minister to them and love on them. And you know, this is a big reason why we do community events, is to love on our community, connect with our community. And so we are excited to have the opportunity, and it was an absolute joy. We look forward to doing it again next year. Just a few announcements again to run over. We've got the couples retreat coming up next weekend at Pickwick. And a reminder that check-in starts at 4. The retreat starts at 6:30. Dinner and breakfast are not included. So if you want to eat at the lodge, dinner starts at 4:30. There's some other places within 15 to 20 minutes of the resort if you want to look for something a little bit different. But if you plan on eating dinner at the lodge, let Jamie know by tomorrow morning by 11 a.m. so she can go ahead and add you to a reservation list. If you can't get that to her by 11, you'll need to call the restaurant and make reservations for yourself. It'll just be easier. Let Jamie do all the hard work that she's used to doing anyways. Just shoot her a message. Breakfast at the lodge is going to be Saturday morning from 7 to 9:30. No reservations will be needed for that. And Saturday we'll be out at the pavilion for the sessions. There are picnic tables to sit at, but apparently you are encouraged to bring a chair or something cushy to sit on, and the weather's going to be absolutely perfect, so ladies, bring your heavy coats. But that's just a general heads up on things going on with the marriage retreat. Tonight, there is no marriage class at the Hendersons. That has wrapped up, but we do have our adult smallish Bible study. It'll be at down at our house at the Parsonage this evening at 6 o'clock. You're encouraged to bring a chair and then something to snack on. We're going to fire up a big old bonfire out there. And so we're looking forward to that. Just enjoy a nice evening together, some fellowship and a good word. So come out and join us tonight at 6 o'clock. There are 2 baby showers on the docket now for the church. That's growing the church the old-fashioned way. We've got a baby shower honoring Erica Daniel. It will be Sunday, October 8th from 1 to 3. At Littleville Baptist Church. And then we've got Savannah and John Riley. Their baby shower will be here on October 15th from 2 until 4. And then Sundays towards the end of the month, already starting to schedule out. I love this. We've got our pastor appreciation meal will be Sunday, October 22nd following service. And then that evening, we've got a couple of things going on. We've got our business meeting here at 5 a.m., and we're going to get in, do some business with the church. And then that evening, what's that? Please be here at a.m. And we're going to get that done early that day. So now 5 p.m. It is following the a.m. service. I'm sorry, I'm reading too fast. It's all in the bulletin, y'all. Y'all read your bulletin. Save me some time. But that evening, after the 5 p.m. business meeting, we've got a movie night that we're doing. And I had the privilege of previewing a movie with Brian and Sheena this last week, a movie called What Rhymes with Reason. And it is a story of six teenagers and the struggles that they go with. This movie really targets mental health issues, fears, anxiety, suicide, that sort of thing. But it takes a modern teenage flair and then kind of meshes it with the Goonies and the Breakfast Club. And it was actually extremely well done. It's going to be in movie theaters one night, October 10th, and then for 2 weeks following, churches are going to be able to host an event. We're going to treat it just like actually going to the movie theaters. We legally have to charge per ticket. We're going to cover the cost for our students to come. But the ticket cost will be $10 to come that evening. We'll have some small concessions available. It's going to be a great time for families to come out and watch a fun movie, but with some good faith elements to it. There's some Bible studies attached with it that we'll be following up with our students. But I encourage you guys to come out. I am going to recommend ages 13 and older, as it does deal with some mature themes for our for student ages. So just kind of keep that in mind. And then we've got our fall festival. Will be Sunday, October 29th at 6 o'clock, and you're not allowed to dress up like Taylor Swift. Yeah. Just saying, no. But no, it's going to be a good time. We're looking forward to it. Just a personal announcement. Some of you guys know, but I'll just go ahead and share with the church. October 12th, I go in for some minor back surgery, as minor as back surgery can be. That's going to put me down for a couple of weeks, but once that's done, hopefully we'll get rid of this hitch in my get-up. And we'll all be a little bit better off. So we're looking forward to getting that done, and we'll all be good to go. We've got some backup van drivers. I'm very appreciative for them while I'm going to be down. It is getting into deer season, which means I'm getting ready to lose the Brewers for a little while for van drivers as well. So if you are interested in driving a van, and I know that's none of you here, but if the Lord puts it on your heart that you can help in a van ministry, we need you. So please come and see me. They're an interesting group of kids, but it's a great opportunity to get to know some of them and love on them. And we could certainly use some help for some drivers. So if that's you, come talk to me. Come talk to Brother Jonathan. Talk to Brian and Sheena. They'll tell you how rewarding it is and how much they enjoy it. So let us know, and we've got a place to work you in. So, all right, I think that's all the sermon time. Y'all get a short sermon from my brother Jonathan today because I had to go long on announcements. I'm going to say a word of prayer, and Miss Letha is going to share some scripture with you, and then we got a song we're going to share with you today. Gracious Father, we're thankful this morning that we can come and be here. God, I thank you for the life in the church. God, activities by themselves mean nothing, but done in your name and for your glory, it brings growth of your kingdom. And God, I'm thankful for that growth. God, I pray that everything we do as a church would not be for our own sake, but to lift you up and to draw others unto your name. God, we thank you for this opportunity to worship you this morning and to hear your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
For God said, who said, let light shine out of the darkness, has shone in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ.
1, 2, 3. Well, I keep trying to find a light, my own apart from you. Well, I am the king of excuses. Well, I've got one for every selfish thing I do. What's going on inside of me? I despise my own behavior. This only serves to confirm my suspicions. I'm still a man in need of a Savior. I want to be in the light, as you are in the light. I want to shine like the stars in the heavens. Oh Lord, be my light and be my salvation. All I want is to be in the light. And all I want is to be in the light. The disease of self runs through my blood. It's a cancer fatal to my soul. Every attempt on my behalf has failed to bring this sickness under control. What's going on inside of me? I despise my own behavior. This only serves to confirm my suspicions that I'm still a man in need of a Savior. I want to be in the light as you are in the light. I want to shine like the stars in the heavens. Oh Lord, be my light and be my salvation. Cause all I want is to be in the light. All I want is to be in the light.
Honesty becomes me.
There's nothing left to lose.
The secrets that surround me,
your presence have diffused.
Pride has no position,
and riches have no worth.
The pain that once did cover me
has been sentenced to this earth. Tell me what's going on,
what's
inside
going
of me
on?
I despise my Savior. I want to be in the light as you are in the light. I want to shine like the stars in the heavens. Oh Lord, be my light and be my salvation. Cause all I want is to be in the light. All I want is to be in the light. I want to be in the light as you are in the light. I want to shine like the stars in the heavens. Oh Lord, be my light and be my salvation. Cause all I want is to be in the light.
All I want, all I want,
all I want is to be in the light.
All I want, all I want,
all I want is to be.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this chance to worship you, Lord, and to think about your Son, the light that you sent to this earth, and the light that you've shown in each and every one of our hearts, Lord. We are each battling something. We're each battling sin in our life, temptation. God, we have fallen so far from your grace, but we just thank you for the sacrifice that your Son has made, that he has made a way for us to be in your light for all eternity. And God, we just want to hear your words that you have for us this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Wasn't that a good song? I mean, they did an awesome job. And now I get to stand up here and try to preach behind that. So it's good to see you this morning. We do have a lot of folks that are out sick. We got family sickness. We've got, you know, folks in the family that somebody's having to take care of sick. Just a lot going on. And as always, I want to ask you to make sure you call and check on folks. And, you know, let them know that you miss them. You know, if you see a new face, go tell them you're glad to see them. I want to make sure everybody sees there's a flyer in the vestibule out there. We've got a concert going to be down the road here October the 8th. It's the Kellys, and many of you know that group. And if you want to go and hear them, that information's out there. I want to thank everybody that came and helped yesterday on the yard sale, Friday and Saturday. I wasn't able to help much. I was able to come down yesterday and help with the steeple a little bit. And I spent a little bit of time in the back there up in the attic with Brother Cass working and sent some pictures of me down here and him up there, and he's not here today. They're sick, so I can talk bad about him, and he can't punch me in the mouth for doing it. But I got to thinking about it. I'm standing under him as he's standing under the steeple. And I got thinking about what a great fella he is and what a good friend he is to me. But as I'm looking up at him and I'm standing, my back's killing me from standing on wonky boards all morning. But as I'm looking up at him, it dawns on me that the cross is going to be right above him. And that when I look, I should see the cross. And that's the way we all ought to be in our lives. When somebody looks at us, they ought to look right through us and see that cross. Do they? Do you see how dark things are in the world around you today? I mean, we were talking in Sunday school this morning. Brother Brian was challenging everybody to go out and share. And I was just thinking how bad the world is. And it's because I'm not sharing. We're not sharing. Many of you read my posts. I don't post much. I lurk on Facebook just to see what's for sale that I can trade some junk for some junk. But I posted this week that there was a knock on my door Thursday morning that changed the whole group of my job. One of my coworkers was killed in a car wreck. Shock. I mean, a big shock to the system. We had a memorial service last night. And I mean, he was 45, 46 years old, young man with a young family and a bright future ahead of him, was a very key person to our job. Kept our wheels greased, so to speak. It's been 13 months since my last coworker passed. And I told him, I said, guys, y'all are sick of me telling you this, but you've got to be ready because you never know when your day's going to come. I want to talk to you this month about defeating the darkness. When you get in a bad place, when you get in a hard situation, when you get to where you don't know what to do and the darkness seems to be crowding in on you, your light bulb is growing dim and you cannot see a way out. That's been on my heart. And I want to try to give you the tools and the encouragement to understand when you see it coming and how to deal with that. I want you to first turn with Ephesians chapter 6 with me. This is just going to be a focal passage that we're going to talk about every Sunday this month unless the Lord changes us. We're going to talk about Ephesians 6 and verse 12. And this ought to be something that you know by heart, or you know the gist of it pretty well. This is one of those scriptures that you need to know because it speaks volumes to what's going on in the world today. And this was wrote some thousands of years ago in times when it seemed that we're just as bad as they could be. And you imagine how far we've come in that thousands of years and how much worse it is, yet this scripture is oh so still applicable for us. Ephesians 6:12, if you're there. It says, "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places." That person that cuts you off in traffic, it's not them, it's the whatever driving them, whatever's moving them. That person that lips off at you, that person that cheats you, that person that steals from you, that person that hurts you, it's not the flesh and blood, it's what's been allowed to control that flesh and blood. That darkness that has crept in on them is now creeping in on you. Does that darkness ever creep in on us and then creep in on somebody else? I want to talk to you this morning about the mark of Cain. We're going to go back to Genesis, all the way back to the beginning, Genesis chapter 4. And we're going to look at the life of Cain. You remember in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Then He made man. Then He caused a deep sleep to come over Adam, and He took a rib out of his side, and He made Eve, and they were perfect. They were in a beautiful place, and then sin entered in, and God put them outside the Garden of Eden. And the Bible says that Adam knew his wife and had Cain, and then knew his wife, and he had Abel, had two sons, and it was outside the garden, but so far so good, right? Like a lot of us, it may not be an ideal situation, but you know, it is what it is. Man, if I heard that once, I've heard it 1,000,000 times. It is what it is. I mean, that's like, you know what it is by the way that it is, right? It makes absolutely no sense. But in Genesis chapter 4, we're going to start looking at the story of Adam and Eve having their children. And the first point we're going to make this morning is we're going to see the jealousy factor. The jealousy factor. Starting in verse 1, Genesis chapter 4, the Bible says, "And Adam knew his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain, and said, I have gotten a man from the Lord. And she again bare of his brother Abel, and Abel was a keeper of sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground." So let's stop right there and make sure you understand two sons. There's been a lot of argument that they were twins. They are not. One is older than the other. God pronounced a curse on Eve in the Garden of Eden that in childbirth, her troubles would be greatly multiplied. The fact that she lived to have a child, let alone two children, is a miracle in and of itself. That means that God's grace was still on them, even though they had been put outside the Garden of Eden. There's never a place that you can go that God can't still reach you. No matter how dark it is, there is still a way out. So here she's had two children. One is a tiller of the ground. One is the keeper of the sheep. And in process of time, verse 3, it came to pass that Cain brought of the fruit of the ground an offering unto the Lord. And Abel, he also brought of the firstlings of his flock and of the fat thereof. And the Lord had respect unto Abel and to his offering. But unto Cain and to his offering, he had not respect. And Cain was very wroth, and his countenance fell. And the Lord said unto Cain, Why art thou wroth? And why is thy countenance fallen? If thou dost well, shall thou not be accepted? And if thou dost not well, sin lieth at the door, and unto thee shall be his desire, and shall rule over him. The jealousy factor. Is there power in jealousy? Is there such a thing as deriving power to be jealous over somebody? I can't sing like Brother Bill can. I can't play and sing like Brother Tim can. I'm jealous of those things. I can't play the drums like Lydia does. I'm jealous of those things. And does it really give me any power to be jealous of those things? Or does it bring me down a notch? Because now I start thinking of all the things I cannot do myself. And I start looking at myself in a different light. Cain became jealous of Abel's offering. Now, theologians have claimed that Cain just brought what he wanted to for an offering, whereas Abel brought his first fruits, that is, the best thing that he had. Now, go back to where they had been thrown out of the Garden of Eden. How many of us would have said, I'm done with you, God? But Adam taught his sons to sacrifice to God. To make a sacrifice, which was an atonement for the sins that had been committed in their life, even before the Ten Commandments were written. They were already trying to walk in a godly lifestyle, but there was a problem. There was a problem with Cain's offering, and it made him jealous of his brother. Over in Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 4, I want to read you this out of the Christian Study Bible. Now, this is all the way over in the New Testament. That's talking about something that happened at the beginning of time. By faith, Abel offered to God a better sacrifice than Cain did. By faith, he was approved as a righteous man because God approved his gifts, And even though he is dead, he still speaks through his faith. Faith is something that carries through generations. Hebrews indicates there was no faith in Cain's offering. It was just general items being sacrificed. What's left over? What could not be used? You remember when Jesus went in the temple? You ever heard somebody say, "I'm so mad, I'm fixed to start flipping tables," like Jesus did? When he went in there, he saw that they were selling sickly sacrifices. Whatever's left over that nobody else wanted, since nobody else wanted it, I'll just give it to God. That started with Cain. The lack of faith in Cain led to his offering having no respect from God. And this perceived favoritism led to raging jealousy. I am jealous of my brother. You know what jealousy means? Jealous resentment against a rival, a person enjoying success or advantage, or against another's success or advantage itself. I'm jealous because you are successful and I am not. You know what happens when you point at somebody? You got three fingers pointing right back at you. I'm not three times what I accuse you of being once. Back in verse 7, God said, "If you do well, shall you not be accepted? And if you don't do well, then sin lies at your door. And unto you, shall be sin's desire. And sin shall rule over you." If you don't do well, sin lies at your door. Now back in our first scripture in Ephesians, we wrestle not against flesh and blood. Sin has no flesh, does it? Sin doesn't have skin. Sin doesn't have bones. Sin doesn't have teeth, eyes, hair, toenails, arms, legs. Sin has no flesh. And jealousy also has no flesh. It does not exist in an entity out of itself, yet it controls us. How? It's a power. It's using the power, the principalities, the rulers of the darkness of this world against spiritual wickedness in high places. That's how it controls us. So how are we doing in regards to jealousy? Are we living in faith? Are we trusting in God? Can we say that blessings are His to give as He so chooses? If He blesses this person with this ability, or this person with this ability, or that person with that ability, is that any of our business, or is that God's business? Do we have any right to be jealous of that? Are we offering God the best sacrifice that we can? Excuse me, insulation in the attic will get you. Are we offering the best sacrifice that we can to God, or are we just giving Him what we can't do anything else with? I got nothing better to do, so maybe I'll give God 15 minutes of my time. I'll bless Him with reading of the Scripture and praying to His holiness. Does sin lie at our door? You know what happens to a mangy old dog that lies at your door? If you don't run it off, you start feeding it. And then you name it. And it's ugly, and it stinks, and it's nasty, and I mean it's repulsive, and you feed it, and you talk to it, and you love it, and you let it in the house, and then it's on the couch, and it's in the bed with you, and it's watching TV with you, and that dog ain't changed a bit, has it? It's your perception of the dog that changed. Sin does that. Who is it, or what is it, that we're jealous of? Number two, when anger rages. Defeating the darkness is the jealousy factor, and then there's anger. when anger comes on and it just rages in our life, look back to our scripture there in verse 8. And Cain talked with Abel his brother, and it came to pass when they were in the field that Cain rose up against Abel his brother and slew him, he killed him. And the Lord said unto Cain, where is Abel thy brother? And he said, I know not. Am I my brother's keeper? And he said, what hast thou done? The voice of thy brother's blood cries unto me from the ground. Is there power in anger? When you get mad and you get angry and that blood rush comes over you, does that give you power? The ability to be able to hurt someone both physically and mentally? To be able to just ruin their day like they've ruined your day? Does that give you power? It's a drug. It's a rush. It's something that you can become addicted to. Cain was very angry. Verse 5 says he was wroth. That means stormy, violent, turbulent. Have you ever got so mad that you blacked out? You don't remember anything. Man, is that dangerous or what? I mean, there have been times that I've stepped outside my body and thought, man, what are you doing? You're going to have to dial it down a notch. Road rage. Company rage. Spousal abuse. Child abuse. That's wrath. That's stormy, violent. There ain't no way you need to be doing this turbulent anger. Cain perceived he was wrong, and he was going to make it right. I'm going to get even with you for this. Have you ever wondered what that first fight looked like? What kind of weapon was used? Was it just bare hands? Did he just choke the life out of his little brother? What did he say when he begged for his life? How much anger do you need to hate someone enough to kill them? Why is anger so dangerous? Because it is sin. Because it lies at everybody's door. It's laying right there. It's trying to find a home. It's trying to find somebody to feed it, somebody to name it, somebody to rub it, let it in on the couch to watch TV with them and sleep in the bed with them at night. It's looking for somebody. If you think it's not outside your door, you've kid yourself. Anger doesn't have flesh. It's not wearing skin and hair and teeth and eyes and arms and legs. It controls us to a point, though, to where we become a slave to it. Anger makes us do things that we cannot believe. Like plot to kill our little brother. Like dream of somebody's death. Like actually taking someone's life. Anger also removes any trace of remorse. It makes you so callous that you don't care what you did. You look at the face of God and you point your finger and say, I'm not my brother's keeper. He had it coming. He deserved what he got. I don't know where he is, and what's more than that, I don't care. I don't care what happened to him. I don't care where they are. It's not my problem. As a matter of fact, God, I did the world a favor. You ever heard somebody say that? World's better off without him or her or them. Are we doing well regarding anger? How do we go from being a brother to having such lack of empathy, no remorse? Sin lay at the door of Cain and it started controlling Cain and it told him what to do. And little by little it took over his life and forced him to kill his brother. But what about us? How are we doing regarding anger? Are we living in faith? God, you've got me through so many times before. Will you not get me through this one as well? Are we trusting in God when He said, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord? Are we trusting God and not becoming sinfully angry? What does the Bible say? Ephesians 4:26-27. Be ye angry and sin not. Let not the sun go down upon your wrath, neither give place to the devil. He's lying at your door. He's ready to get in. Ephesians 6, 12, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, against principalities, powers, against the rulers of the darkness of the world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Number 3, the wrong kind of mark. If we want to defeat wickedness in this world, in our life, we've got to see the jealousy that leads to anger, and then we've got to see how it marks us. Back in our passage here in verse 11, God is about to pronounce a curse on Cain, and He says, "And now art thou cursed from the earth, which has opened her mouth to receive thy brother's blood from thy hand. When thou tillest the ground, it shall not henceforth yield unto thee her strength. A fugitive and a vagabond shall thou be in the earth." And Cain said unto the Lord, "My punishment is greater than I can bear. Behold, thou hast driven me out this day from the face of the earth, and from thy face shall I be hid. And I shall be a fugitive and a vagabond in the earth, and it shall come to pass that everyone that finds me shall slay me." Isn't this rightfully so far? He killed his brother in cold-blooded murder. He was so jealous and got so angry that he killed his brother, but God said. Verse 15, "Therefore, whosoever slayeth Cain, vengeance shall be taken on him sevenfold. And the Lord set a mark upon Cain, lest any finding him should kill him." If all is fair and right, God could have thumped Cain off the face of the earth. But what did he do? He had mercy on him. Sin has consequences, doesn't it? Cain was cursed from the earth. His work would be much toil. The ground would not provide as it could for him. He would be a fugitive from God's judgment. He would be a vagabond, never having a steady place to lay his head. Not only does sin have consequences, but decisions carry for life. Now, how fair is that? Whatever you decide today affects you for the rest of your life, whether you think it or not. The problem with jealousy is that it is not a temporary king in your life. Once you let jealousy take hold and set in, it takes over for a long time. The same thing with anger. Anger is not a temporary king. It does not just control you for this minute and not for the next minute. Once anger sets in and takes over, it's got you. Could Cain have been jealous over Abel for only one day? Jealousy owns us. It controls us. It takes over our life. It ruins the plans that God has for us. Could Cain have been angry over Abel for only one day? Anger, it owns us. It takes over and controls our life, and it ruins the plans that God has for us. But God hears when we petition Him. Cain said, "This burden is so great, I can't stand this." He says, "I got myself into something I cannot get myself out of. God, I need your help." Have you ever said that? "God, I've dug a ditch. I can't get out of it. It's all my doing. It's all my fault. I got myself here. It was none of you. But God, I need your help. Please. Please help me." The consequences remain forever, but the earthly burdens can be too great. We have regret. Are there any things in life that you regret? "Man, if I could just go back. Man, if I'd have pushed door B instead of door A. Or if I'd have checked that box instead of this box." What about remorse? "Man, I did it and I can't fix it and it just bothers me forever. And now that's led to self-doubt because I'm afraid to make another decision. What if I make the same mistake that I made so far back there and I'm going to pay dearly for it again?" Cain said, "I cannot bear this burden." Cain said in verse 14, everyone would treat him like he treated his brother. It's okay for me to kill my little brother, but God, everybody's going to try to slay me. That's not fair. God, that's too much to bear. God didn't say, "Well, you didn't think about that when you killed Abel, did you?" They'll slay him. Maybe that means ruin his character. Maybe that means shun his friendship. Maybe that means push him away. Maybe that means take his life. But God always had a plan for salvation. Always back when he said in the beginning, God had a plan and a purpose. And he said, whoever slays Cain will face God's wrath. In verse 15, he says, it'll be sevenfold taken out on them. Cain would not have an easy journey due to the sin that he committed, but God's hand would always be upon him. And you know, we're not promised an easy journey. But is not God's hand upon us? Do we live differently with salvation, knowing Jesus Christ is our personal Lord and Savior, or do we use it as a license to sin? I know I'm going to heaven. I'm saved. I've been baptized. My name is on a church roll. There ain't nothing you can do to me. I've got this covered. I'm good. I'm going to go out and live my life because I'm forgiven. Are we living like nothing can touch us? I can do anything I want to do. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, and there are no consequences. Did Cain live differently, knowing that nobody could slay him now? Are we abusing the mark that God has placed on us? Have we said, I'm forgiven, so why bother? Do we have the wrong kind of mark on us? Lastly, life after darkness. You got to get a hold of jealousy. You cannot let it turn to anger. You cannot misuse the mark that God has placed on your life. And there is life after darkness. Back to our passage, verse 16. We're going to try our best to pronounce some of these names here. And Cain went out from the presence of the Lord and dwelt in the land of Nod on the east of Eden. And Cain knew his wife, and she conceived and bare Enoch. And he builded a city and called the name of the city after the name of his son Enoch. And Enoch was born Irad, and Irad begot Mahajael, and Mahajael begot Methusael, and Methusael begot Lamech. Cain did not wander alone. What did Moses say? God, I can't go to speak to Pharaoh because I'm slow of speech. I'm tongue-tied. And he sent somebody with him, yet they never had to speak for Moses. Right? Aaron never spoke. Cain had a wife. Cain had children and generations after. Cain did not see all this, though, when his judgment was pronounced, did he? God, this is more than I can bear. You're going to make me wonder. You've cast me out from the face of the earth. You ever been there when realization sets in that jealousy got a hold of your anger and you've used your mark wrongly? God still had a plan for Cain. So let me ask you this. What's happened in our life that brought the darkness? You say, brother, there's no darkness in my life. Yes, there is. Because not everybody's smiling. Not everybody's in a good mood. Not everybody's seeing the glasses half full rather than half empty. What's the darkness in your life? Is it pain? Is it aches? Is it heartaches? Is it finances? Is it spiritual problems? Is it somebody, something, somewhere? What is it? What is it that you're wrestling against and you've mistakenly said it's got flesh and blood on it rather than being a power and a principality? What's happened in our life to bring the darkness? Because we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. What is it we're facing? You as an individual, you as a family, you as an employee or whatever it is you are, what are you facing today? The darkness that's trying to put your light out. You know, the biggest fear I had when they knocked on my door Thursday is somebody coming to me and asking me, why would God let this happen? You ever had to answer that question before? Why would God let this happen? Young man, good career, beautiful family, lots of great hobbies, everybody liked him, key member of our team. Why would God let that happen? You may be in your situation and you're saying, why would God let this happen to me? I thought I did the right thing. I thought I was doing the right thing. I thought everything was okay, and now I see all this darkness coming in on me. I'm jealous of things I ought not be jealous of. I'm angry about things. I get angry about being angry, and then that makes me angry. And then I get angry because of that, and then I circle back around to why I was angry to start with, and oh yeah, let's don't forget what this person did to you. You ain't got angry about that yet, and before long, your anger level is all the way up to here. Is it because we've let sin sleep on our doorstep? Is it because we've named it? Is it because we fed it? Is it because we let it come in and watch TV with us? Is it because we let it sleep in the bed with us? You ready to get rid of this darkness? You see, we've done this, but the burden is too great. We need to go to God and we need to say, God, this burden is too great. You told me, you warned me not to fool around with that, and what did I do? I let it sleep on my doorstep. You know, it was okay sleeping out in the field because I couldn't see it. And it was all right maybe in the edge of the yard because I could turn the light off. But every morning I went to leave, I was bumping it with the door. And it was right there on my doorstep. And you know, it's just a short crawl in the house. And once it gets in the house, man, it's everywhere. We need to tell God what we let lay at our door. Then we need to tell God we're jealous of something. Then we need to tell God that we're angry about something. And then we need to tell God we need your help. We need to tell God we need the mark of safety on our life. You know what that mark looks like for a child of God? That. There's a light, and it shines on us everywhere we go. This means I'm a child of God. And the powers and the principalities and the darkness and the wickedness can never overcome me because the light of Jesus shines on me. The battery on this phone will go dead eventually, and I'll be in semi-darkness. But as long as Jesus shines on me, I will never be in the darkness. God's got me. God's got this. And God's got you if you know Jesus as personal Lord and Savior of your life. But what is it that's trying to put that light out in your life? What is it that's trying to squish that so you can't do what God's calling you to do? What plans did God have for Abel that Cain took away? What future did God have set aside for Abel that Cain took away? I don't want to take away somebody's future plans that God has for them by being jealous of them, by being so angry. Then I'm talking to myself here. I don't want to do anything to stop God's plan in somebody else's life. I need to remember that I'm marked. I need to tell God, God, I want life, not death. Because when I kill somebody's spirit, I kill that soul, and I condemn them to an eternal life of hell. Tell God what sin lies at your door. I'm going to ask you to bow with me right now with every head bowed and every eye closed, please. Right now, I want you to think, what is it that I've allowed to lay at my door? Something on the internet? Something on a magazine? Something on the television? Something that I've allowed to come through my ears into my life. Somebody that's come into my life that don't need to be in my life. Those dark influences that I've allowed in. What is it? It's sitting right here beside me watching TV. It's telling me what I need to watch. You may say, I've done let it in the bed with me. It's sleeping right there. Whatever it's got, I've got. It's never too late. Even though you let it on the doorstep or let it on the couch or let it in the bed, say, God, this burden is too much for me to bear. I did this, but God, I need your help. It may be we need to turn off some internet. It may be we need to turn off some subscriptions. Maybe we need to turn off the TV. Maybe we need to change the sheets of outlook in our life on our bed. What is it that we need to do this morning to get rid of the jealousy, the anger, and misusing the mark that God has placed on our life? Do you want life after darkness? We're not wrestling against somebody or something. We're wrestling against powers and principalities of darkness that we cannot defeat. It's going to take a mighty God to do that in our lives. If you think you can do that on your own, you're kidding yourself. Call out to God right now. God, I'm angry and I'm sinning with anger. God, I'm jealous and it's causing rage in my life. I am wroth, God, because I think I have been done wrong, Lord. And I'm afraid of what's going to happen next if we don't get control of this. I want you to call out to God. If you need to in just a minute, come to the altar. Leave it here. Lay it down. Say, God, I've got this problem. I need you to take it and leave it. Find a brother or a sister that you can talk to, somebody that can help you. I'd be honored to pray with you. But the point of this whole thing is, folks, if we let that sin start controlling us, it's going to be very costly to not just us, but to somebody else. Father, I don't want to be the Cain in this story. I don't want to be the one that destroys somebody else's life. God, and I know this has stomped on me pretty good, Lord, because I let the anger go to the roof too many times, Lord. God, I'm going to give it to you, Lord. The people in my life, the ones that, Father, I just don't understand, God, I pray that you just give me a spiritual filter, Lord, so I don't even see the ignorance. God, the ones that try to run me in the ditch, Father, the ones that try to run me down the road, God, whatever it is that's going on, Lord, that's yours. I don't want it anymore, Lord. I want to be free. And I want to pray that for those in this building right now, Lord. Anybody on our campus, Lord, give us true freedom, Lord, from the things that are holding us back and holding us down. God, a lot of people here today are making a decision. Am I going to keep doing this or am I going to cut it off? Am I going to keep letting it lay at my doorstep or am I going to run it off? Am I going to kick it off the couch? Am I going to kick it out of bed? God, where has it got in my life that it never should have been? Lord, it may be painful for a minute. And we may seem like we're living as a vagabond with no place to lay our head, but God, you'll never leave us and you'll never forsake us. Lord, even Cain had a wife and children. God, you put a mark on him to remind him, Lord, that nobody's going to harm him. Father, we need to see that mark in our life today. I'm asking you to speak to us, Lord. I'm going to ask you to stand with your heads bowed and your eyes closed. If you need to come on down to this altar and pray, you come on. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus, and none of this made a lick of sense, we need to talk. We need to talk today because you're not promised tomorrow, not even the rest of today. Won't you be obedient to whatever God is telling you that's in your life that you don't need in your life? Let's do whatever God's asking us to do.
I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory. And I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. And oh, how he loves us. Oh, oh, how he loves us. How he loves us. Oh. like a hurricane. I am a tree bending the knee, the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. Oh, how he loves, yeah, he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us.
Holy Christ. Song was talking about how much God loves us. God loves us so much to meet you right where you are. All you have to do is reach out your hand and he'll take it. My prayer is that you know the invitation never ends. If there's anything I can do for you, please, please let me know. I'm going to ask our Deacon of the Month, Brother Tab Garrison, if he'll close us out in prayer.